the only answer to the darkness. You're the only right among the wrong. You're the only hope among the chaos. You are the voice that calls me on, louder than every lie, my sword in every fight. The truth will chase away the night. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle.
Good morning. Welcome to Emmanuel Christian Reformed Church live stream worship service. Thank you for coming to join us here online. No matter where we are, be it in the sanctuary, be it at home, be somewhere, anywhere on the planet, we can always come together to worship the Lord. For it's not just by our bodies, but by our hearts, our very spirits, that we can worship God as a community. So do know that there are other people throughout Richmond and a few outside of Richmond who are worshiping with you as we come together. And so, as we come together to worship, I'm going to read some parts, but you'll see on the screen that there's some bolded parts. That's where you should read out loud, because we're going to do it sort of Dora style. I'm not going to say anything. That's your part. So, with that little warning, please join me now for a call of worship. You who are poor, why have you come? You who are brokenhearted, why have you come? You who are captives, why have you come? You who are prisoners, why have you come? You who mourn, why have you come? Then you who are welcome here in this place where Jesus offers blessings to all. And so we trust that Jesus blesses us. And so let's come together now for a time of prayer, of adoration. Please join me in a prayer. Lord, who gives us sunshine, who gives us rain, who gives us wind and calm breezes, who created the feet beneath us and the sky above us, and a Lord who made our bodies from the muscles and bones, from the nerve endings, to the tiniest cell, to the most complex system of our mind. O Lord, you have done such wonderful things. And you, O Lord, have made our families our friends. The whole society, O Lord, has become because you are guiding us. You are rescuing us. And O Lord, though we may be in our homes, may we know that our spirits are more free because of you, that they cannot be tied down. And O Lord, may our spirits rise up to give you glory and worship, to love you and to adore you. O Lord, we give you praise. Fill our hearts wherever we are and throughout the day to know that you are our King, that you create wonder and majesty, that you, O Lord, cannot be contained but are everywhere. O Lord, be glorified, and may we understand these great mysteries in Jesus Christ who died for us. In his name we pray. Amen. And so, since we know the Lord is great and powerful, he can hear us no matter where we are. Let's come together now with songs, songs from Emmanuel. Let's sing together.
Good morning. It's good to worship with you this morning. As we worship in our respective homes, it's a good habit for us to actually have an intimate family worship within the confines of our home and praise God from there. Let's make our homes our temple, our sanctuary, as we sing And praise God, He is indeed the breath in our lungs, the one that fixes the broken and our hope in this time of crisis. Let's declare how great our God is.
Praise are you, Lord. clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Say with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our
songs in our hearts, the songs creating a feeling of worship, of praise, of God's presence. Let's come together bringing our mind to give glory to God and to understand those deeper things. We come to the Learning Our Faith portion in the bulletin, where I have a question, and I will read out the answer, but I want you to read it out too. So hear this question. This question. Christian, what do you believe? We believe in the loving God, the loving kingdom of God, through Christ upon us, within us, beyond us. We believe the loving kingdom is like a mustard seed, sown in apparent insignificance, growing into the magnificence for the greening of the world. We believe the loving kingdom is like a yeast, inserted in a humble, insignificant dough of life, expanding into enough bread for the world. We believe the loving kingdom of God is like a treasure lost and rendered insignificant under the ground, now found with joy and thanksgiving. We believe the loving kingdom of God is like pearls. All others become insignificant when the largest, most beautiful pearl is found. We believe in the loving kingdom of God through Christ upon us, within us, beyond us, where the meek and the poor, the merciful and the hungry rejoice with the angels of God. Loving God, we believe. Shatter our unbelief. And so we have a scripture reading to go along with this statement from Mark 8, verse 35. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. And so we know that the Lord will save our lives if we cling to him. So let us come to the Lord with confession, asking for the forgiveness of our sins, and then praying for the life of the world, for our family members next to us, from our friends in other houses, to people and strangers on the other side of the planet. Let's pray for this world, for healing and the sharing of the gospel, for our love for God. Please join me in this call and response, prayer of confession and intercession. God, you became human. You became so we could be forgiven and transformed. Forgive us of our sins, of things that separate us from you, that blind us to your presence. And now a time of silent prayer where we focus our hearts on God, putting our trust in him. A time of silence. O Lord, we come to you where we are now. We come to you because you, O Lord, can be found everywhere. O Lord, we come to you seeking forgiveness, for we have sinned, both in and out, in our mind and through our bodies, through our actions and inactions, from our little thoughts that belittle your creation and people. O Lord, we have sinned. Forgive us, O Lord, from those things that separate us from you, from your creation, from ourselves, from the love that you have given. O Lord, forgive us. And please hear the cry of those in most need of you, those laying in the hospitals, those working hard to ensure that society can keep going, that, O Lord, that there is food and medicine, that there is warmth, that there is energy to be put into the things that we do, working, O Lord, so that we can come together again and give you glory and worship. Lord, we pray, grant strength, a supernatural strength to those who work. Grant supernatural healing to those who are sick. Give, O Lord, a supernatural hope to us who are waiting, especially for your return. And please, O Lord, may you give a supernatural passion for your gospel and love and the ability to share it no matter what boundaries are between us. May you be with the leaders of the world, from the smallest position in a office to the greatest powers of world leaders. Please, O Lord, grant them compassion and conviction in their hearts. Give them wisdom and courage and humility, that they may, O Lord, be a blessing to the world and not cause more trouble. And may we too, O Lord, have courage, passion, and wisdom to be a blessing to the world that you have made. O Lord, please hear our prayers. O Lord, have mercy. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And now we come to a word of grace, because we know the Lord forgives us and wants to be with us. So hear this word of grace with a response. Romans 8, verses 13 to 17. If you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The peace of Christ be with you. And so, with his peace inside of us, letting go of our sins, trusting in the Lord who can heal us and get us through any trouble, let's come together now with a song of renewal here at Emmanuel. so with the song, bringing peace to our hearts, helping us to focus on the Lord, let's now draw our attention to a time of thanksgiving, a time where we can give back to the Lord, not just in song, but with our hearts, and as a community, with our means. Even though we're not here together as a community in person, we can still give. We still have the ability to give an offering. If you go to the website, you'll Emmanuel Christian Reformed Church website, you'll see that we have set up a e-transfer way of giving donation and giving our offerings. So please take notice of that. We have that ability to give even if we're not here in the sanctuary. And those offerings do good things. They help us share the gospel. It helps those in need. It helps us be a community. So please, don't stop giving. But most of all, we shouldn't stop giving thanks to the Lord. So please join me now in a prayer of thanksgiving. Let's pray together. Thank you, O Lord, for the ones that we have around us, for the ones that we have close to us, and those that we have in other rooms and other houses. Thank you, O Lord, for the community that we have. And thank you, O Lord, for your Spirit, for your Holy Spirit guiding us. O Lord, it guides us into salvation. And O Lord, it also guides those who can do so much good and be such a blessing to this world. We thank you, O Lord, for doctors and nurses, for scientists and the research. We thank you, O Lord, for police officers. We thank you, Lord, for deliverers. We thank you, Lord, for those who go out, especially in this troubling time, and continue to be a blessing to the world, ensuring, O Lord, that we have hope. O Lord, we give you thanks. We give you praise. And we ask, O Lord, that you would take the offering that we give, that you would take what we give, both in our means and our actions, our thoughts, our prayers. May you take them, O Lord, and put them to good use. Use to share the gospel. Use to share your love. Use to share and heal the world among us. O Lord, we give you thanks. And may you give us a passion to continue to give you thanks and to continue to be a people who live in Christ Jesus, in whom we have our being. O Lord, we give you thanks and praise. And in the name of Jesus Christ, our King, amen. And now we come to the community portion of the bulletin. And though we may not meet in person, do know that we still try to keep up the news. We still try to gather things to ensure that the entire community knows what's going on. So please go to Emmanuel Christian Reformed Church's website. There you'll see the most updated information and news. So please click on the website and see what we have going on. And with that, we now come to the time of a message, where we meditate upon God's word and the message given. So please enjoy this message from our guest preacher, Pastor Elaine. Thank you.
Good morning. As I look out at these empty chairs, I'm struck by two things. First, that God does not dwell in buildings such as these, but rather, God is found with his people wherever they are. So for those of you at home, know that you are the church wherever you may be. So worship fully and deeply. God is with you. Second, I'm confident that even though our lives have suddenly been upended at an alarming pace, God's grace is ever present. That we can all still worship, even remotely via technology, is testament to that. And in the midst of all the bad news about the state of this pandemic, may you be equally confident that our God remains at work. Wherever you see goodness and mercy, there is a sure testimony to our God, from whom all goodness and mercy is rooted. May these truths bring you peace this morning and in the weeks to come. Building from last week, which was Gospel Sunday, this week the assigned text is found in Acts chapter 17. And the main question we will be tackling is, how can we share the gospel well? I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one racked with anxiety at the thought of sharing the gospel. Even though I've been previously trained to do it, I am still anxious about it. I'm not sure that the way I've learned it is the best way. I'm not sure I do it properly, let alone well. And if I was already nervous to share the gospel back in my birth country of the Philippines, which is predominantly a Christian country, I'm even more anxious to do it here. In the Canadian context, the task feels even harder, since there seems at first glance to be very little appetite for Christianity among Canadians. In fact, I've heard anecdotes from church planters that the province of BC is one of the hardest areas to plant churches in, because there are so many other things that compete for people's attention. So how are we to share the gospel? How can we do it well? In our passage this morning in Acts, the Apostle Paul gives us a glimpse of how he shared the gospel in Athens. And in his example, we can begin to understand what this fundamental task truly entails. Let's turn to the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 16 to 34. Please do read along with me at home. Acts 17, verse 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious, for as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead." When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. This is the word of the Lord. The first thing I'd like us to notice in our passage this morning is the emotion that the city of Athens evokes in Paul. Verse 16 in the NIV says, "Paul was deeply distressed." In the ESV, the same emotion is translated as "the spirit being provoked." And in the Message, the emotion is translated as "anger." This deep emotion can be explained by the nature of the city of Athens. One of the most prominent features of the city is its plethora of cultic worship. Numerous temples, altars, and images dominated the skyline and infrastructure of the city. Some estimate there may have been well over 73,000 statues of various kinds representing different deities in Athens. The number and diversity of the idols and images in Athens led to Paul feeling distress, great upset, and anger. What I would like to focus on, however, is not necessarily that Paul felt distress and anger. What's more important to note is how Paul reacted to his distress and anger. While most of us, if put in his shoes, may have just written off the Athenians as a hopeless lot and proclaimed good riddance, Paul was deeply moved to offer them a different hope. Paul was moved to share good news. He was angry, yes, but his anger did not lead him to condemn or to withdraw from the Athenians. Rather, his anger led him to engage them in order to share the gospel to them. How are we to share the gospel? How can we do it well? Evangelism that is done well must begin with a desire to understand. Paul didn't have to stay in Athens. His distress could have led him to leave and move on to the next place. But Paul, having witnessed and known deeply the transformative grace and love that Jesus offered, could not leave such a people without sharing the hope that only can be found in Jesus. Paul's anger did not lead him to despise the Athenians. Rather, Paul moved beyond his anger and distress to seek to understand why the Athenians worshipped so many idols. Paul realized that the plethora of idols revealed the Athenians' fear of the gods and their desire to worship. And so in verse 22, Paul says, "Men of Athens, I see that every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God. Now what you worship as something unknown, I am going to proclaim to you.'" When Paul took the time to walk around the city and look carefully, he succeeded in finding a point of contact in the altar to the unknown God. That inscription showed the depth of the Athenians' fear and their religious striving that they would even erect a temple to an unknown God just in case. Evangelism that is done well must begin with a desire to understand. In hindsight, as I look back, I had learned the evangelism expulsion method to share the gospel. And in using that method, I realized that I didn't really listen well to the people I talked to. Instead of listening to understand, I was listening for key words and cues that would move the conversation along to my goal, which was to get the person to pray, to repent, and accept Jesus. I was anxious to get the person to the sinner's prayer. That was my goal. My goal was not to understand deeply. Paul, however, shows that evangelism needs to start with the right heart, the right attitude. In order to evangelize, we must care for the gospel, which in turn will enable us to care for those around us. Paul was distressed by the Athenians, disgusted even, perhaps, but he did not let this negative attitude blind him from the love of God for those very people. Above all, Paul was devoted to Jesus and his gospel, and according to the gospel of Christ, everyone matters to God. Everyone deserves to hear the gospel. Everyone deserves to be seen and not just treated as an object to tally. And every person, whether they know it or not, is striving after God in their own way. What is needed, therefore, is a desire to understand the people around us. What we need are eyes to see these people the way God sees them. What we need is the wisdom to discern how they are striving after God. Even though Paul was genuinely distressed by the idolatry rampant in Athens, he recognized nonetheless that very reality showed that there was something genuine in the people's religious aspirations, that even though they were idolatrous in his eyes, they needed the gospel too. How are we to share the gospel? How can we do it well? Evangelism that is done well not only seeks to understand, it also seeks to be culturally appropriate. Verse 16, while Paul was waiting in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. Paul being in Athens is significant because his location informs us directly as to the motivation behind Paul's approach. Athens was a leading center of learning during his time. It's what we would understand as a great university city, like Cambridge in the UK, for example. In this city, there was a high value given to knowledge because of the various philosophical schools present within the city. We see in our passage that two of these schools, the Epicureans and the Stoics, in particular, were disputing or conversing with Paul in verse 18. They were the ones responsible for bringing him for a more in-depth discussion with the council in the Areopagus. So Paul's audience are who we would consider as academics. These philosophers were familiar with the latest ideas and loved to think through and talk through ideas and theories. This helps to explain why Paul's approach in this instance took such a formal debate or oratorical form. It would be easy to conclude, like lots of people do, that this is the way that we should share the gospel, that we should follow Paul's particular method. Much of Christian apologetics, in fact, does follow a similar didactic form. I'd like to argue, however, that this would not be a wise approach. Furthermore, we are not all called to evangelism by debate, always and in all circumstances. Rather, what this passage shows is that Paul's evangelism was done well because he exercised wisdom in choosing a culturally appropriate approach. He was able to reach his audience because he used language and a method they would understand and accept. The language and method deployed in evangelism ought to vary then depending on one's audience. Evangelism that is done well must not only be culturally appropriate, it must also be culturally engaging. Paul sought to be culturally engaged with his audience. His words were not words of condemnation, but rather points of contact. We have to remember his goal, which is to share the gospel, to announce the identity and nature of the unknown God that the Athenians already sought to worship. He wished to be heard and not dismissed, so he took care to establish a connection, even while upholding God's unchanging truth. In affirming in verse 24 that the one true God is creator and Lord of all and the source of life and breath and everything, Paul connected with the Stoics and Epicureans who were equally disapproving of the Athenian masses' propensity for temples, idols, and divine offerings. In saying in verse 25 that God does not need to be served by human hands, something the Stoics and Epicureans already agreed with, Paul revealed that God cannot be manipulated through offerings or images or prayers. And in affirming in verse 28 that we are God's offspring, Paul maintained that there must be a distinction between humans and God, that of created and creator. We cannot therefore image God with the work of our hands, since we are ignorant of God. Finally, Paul declares that God desires to be sought. When we seek him, we will find him, God promises in verse 27. But before we can do that, God demands repentance and an acknowledgement of our erroneous ways and erroneous thinking. There will come a time, Paul says, when God will judge everyone for their actions. Jesus' resurrection is the proof that a judgment is coming. Therefore, repentance and faith is required. Paul was infinitely wise in what he chose to say to the Athenians. He took care to connect with his audience even while he upheld the truth of the need for repentance and faith in Christ and his resurrection. Thus, Paul's wise words enabled faith in Dionysius, a member of the Council of Areopagus, and Damaris and a number of others. And still others wanted to hear more from him, opening the door to further conversation. How are we to share the gospel? How can we do it well? Paul's example in Acts 17 gives us 3 points to ponder this morning as we consider how we may share the gospel well. First, evangelism has to begin with a heart that seeks to understand. Paul's speech wasn't simply words. They weren't words spoken just to make talking points. They were words spoken by a heart moved by God. They were words spoken by a heart that cared for the people he encountered. They were words spoken from a heart that sought to understand, even as it hoped to persuade. One of the problems of using stock evangelism methods, like evangelism expulsion, for example, is that it presumes conversations can follow a certain pattern. The particularities and uniqueness of individuals are glossed over for universalities. And while these methods can work and have worked, oftentimes the unique circumstances and questions of the person are not given the proper attention. When we share the gospel, how often do we speak out of a sincere heart moved by love and grace, considering carefully how the person we are conversing with is striving after God, no matter how seemingly wrongheaded or mistaken he or she is? Are you seeking to understand where a person is coming from when you relate with those around you? Or have you already made a predetermined judgment about the worthiness or lack of worthiness of your audience? Do these people matter to you only because you think God will ultimately judge you as to how many you will evangelize to in your lifetime? A second point to ponder. In order to share the gospel well, we must be willing to engage deeply. Paul knew that he was speaking to an academically inclined audience in Athens. He knew that they enjoyed listening and conversing about the latest ideas. He knew that they followed a certain format when it came to engaging new ideas. So Paul adapted his approach accordingly. He didn't employ imagery or stories or scriptures that only his Jewish brothers and sisters would understand. Instead, he spoke in the language the Athenian philosophers would understand and welcome. There are some theologians who actually think Paul may have gone too far. They argue that Paul's speech in this passage in Acts is conspicuously absent of the particularities of Yahweh. What these theologians fail to appreciate, however, is that Paul made his speech intentionally secular in order to be heard by his audience. He sought to connect with them first by speaking of ideas they held in common. And in so doing, he was also able to establish enough credibility and thus issue the call of repentance required for faith in Jesus. By employing a culturally appropriate method of evangelism, Paul showed that he was actively engaged with his neighbors. Paul genuinely lived among his community. He knew his neighbors. He knew how they lived. He knew the pulse of the community, so to speak. The great temptation among Christians has always been to withdraw from the world or from culture. After all, Christians are called to be not worldly. And so Christians have sought to establish a parallel culture to the secular world. Christians have established Christian schools, colleges, and universities. Christians have their own music, Christian pop, Christian praise and worship, Christian gospel. Christians produce Christian movies, TV shows, kid videos, and books that offer wholesome entertainment. In this kind of thinking, we can remain pure from worldly influence by participating only in culture coming from Christians. Growing up, I went to a private Christian school in Manila. Almost everyone in that school identified as Christian. We had weekly chapel and morning devotions. The language of Christianity was very familiar to everybody. It was a very conservative school, so we were shielded from all kinds of unsavory cultural influences from the outside. Anything deemed corrupting or worldly was banned and not allowed to be taught. I remember that they would ban anything and everything that was popular at the time. If, for example, dangling earrings were in, we weren't allowed to have them. If long socks were in, we could only wear short socks. It felt to me at that time that there were so many scary things in the world that we needed to avoid so that we would not be corrupted. When I entered a university, I went to a private Catholic university. It was very different from my conservative high school, where everyone had the same language and code of conduct. I experienced what you would say was culture shock. First of all, there was literal culture shock because the school was predominantly Filipino, whereas my high school was predominantly almost all Chinese. Second, people were, to my mind, so liberal. They engaged in and actively sought things that I thought were morally corrupting. Suffice it to say, I had a difficult transition, But eventually I made friends and found a way to participate and engage within that university culture. Just as I had begun to find my way around, though, my parents announced that we would be moving to Canada and that I would go to school there. As you can imagine, I was devastated. If I had thought my private Catholic university was liberal, I was absolutely floored when I went to Steveston for grade 12. Everybody swore. The girls had full-on makeup and wore short skirts and tight tops. People were making out everywhere without a care that they were in public display. If I thought I had culture shock before, I had real culture shock at Steveston High. My initial reaction was to stick to what I knew. Gina also happened to be at Steveston High, so we became close friends and hung out. That offered me some measure of comfort. But because I was so unsure as to how to navigate this new culture, I was quite introverted, and as a result, did not really make any real friends apart from Gina. In university at UBC, it was pretty much the same story for me. I always found it difficult to navigate this new culture, so I stuck to myself and just studied. I don't think I ever really made any good friends at university. I had a few friends, but they were mostly also just people that came from Manila. Looking back, I guess you could say that I disengaged and withdrew from the wider culture around me. I focused on my church family, so the Young Adults Fellowship at church here became a very critical place of support for me. The problem with my way of coping, which I would argue is the same with some Christians, the way they relate to the world and culture around them, is that in distancing myself from the culture around me, I diminished, if not completely erased, my opportunities for sharing the gospel. How could I have shared good news if I couldn't even tell what the people around me saw as good news? If the only people I engage with are Christians, how do I evangelize? Instead of withdrawing, however, we are called to engage our neighbors and to engage them deeply. We are called to be in the world, even while we are not moved by its motivations. Therefore, we need to find appropriate ways to tune in with our culture and the deep desires within it. Only then can we engage in evangelism well, in culturally appropriate and culturally engaged ways. Finally, in order to share the gospel well, we need to be wise with our words. In our social media age, where there are multiple avenues to speak, whether it be Facebook, to blogs, to Instagram, to Twitter, our words need to be wise words in order for them not to fall into two traps. First, our words have a real danger of becoming lost in the cacophony of voices giving their opinions, judgments, and views on everything under the sun. When anyone can say anything on everything, how can we ensure we can still be heard when we share the gospel? How can our words be heard as good news today? How can our words remain true and yet hold out the much-needed love, hope, and grace those who are not disciples of Jesus desperately need? Second, our words have a real danger of adopting the tone of all the other words swirling around at any given moment. Just consider for a moment our current situation of living under a pandemic. I'm standing here in an empty church, preaching to an empty room. Our borders are closed. Our healthcare system is under emergency alert. Shelves are empty because of panic buying. We need to stay home to maintain social distancing. Our elderly neighbors in care homes are on lockdown and cannot be visited. During this time of turmoil and intense anxiety for many, our inboxes, Facebook, and Twitter feeds and TV programs are filled with words that evoke panic, fear, anxiety, hopelessness, despair. It seems every piece of news is bad news. There is no end in sight, or so it seems. Will we ever go back to normal? Will this virus ever be contained? During this challenging period, it is all the more important that those of us who call ourselves disciples of Christ are wise with our words, spoken and posted online. Words matter. Words are not just words. Words evoke feelings in people, And most importantly, our words must not disadvantage our opportunities for sharing the gospel. Do our words during this time echo the hopelessness of our culture? Do our words push people to panic and selfishness? Or are we offering words of hope, words of grace, words of love, even while we speak words of truth? Do we need to exercise some self-control before we write that post or post a tweet? Do we even need to say what's on our minds right now? Let us not forget that our basic calling is to share the gospel. How then can we advance the cause of the gospel during these turbulent times? How can we be wise in our words so that our words become the good news of the gospel to those who hear us? These are the questions each and every one of us needs to be asking today. May Paul's example in Athens illuminate our thoughts and enable us to be wise in our words just as he was. May we truly be witnesses and heralds of God's good news, especially in such unsettling times as this.
Shall we receive the goodness of the Lord together? Wherever you are, please stand. And if you can open your palms and extend your arms a little, a gesture of our openness to receive God's blessings. May the love of Jesus Christ, our Savior, may the love of God, our Father, and may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, our counselor, be with you all from this day forth and evermore. Blessings are pronounced this day in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, let us go out and live our lives in the light of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our worship service ends here, and we'll see you next week for our Holy Communion Sunday worship service. The Lord bless you and keep you. Do spend some time in quiet meditation, and then we shall sign off.